How do you understand anarchism? How does it, what's the idea of the Catholic worker concerning anarchism?
Well, we are very much interested in anarchist thought because a man like Peter Kropotkin wrote a book called Fields, Factories, and Workshops. And he believed that all reform should begin from the bottom up rather than from the top down. And living as we are in a totalitarian era of Hitler's, Mussolini's, and Stalin's, why the whole philosophy of that part of the labor movement interested me. The Amalgamated Clothing Workers and the International Ladies' Garment Workers both had cooperative housing for the poor. I think, I don't know how many generations have lived in those houses. They're still going down the east side and up in the Bronx. They have their clinics, just like Cesar Chavez has 40 acres and a village for the retired Filipinos and a cooperative service station. The thing is, he also was interested in this type of building. It's very much a part of the labor movement, where they, through their organization and through their dedication to bettering conditions, begin right where they are. And in France, they would call it a personalist position.
That's another important word from the Catholic
Workers. Yes, well, at the same time the Catholic Workers started, a magazine started in Paris called called Esprit, the Spirit. And it was dedicated to the personalist and communitarian revolution. And it has to begin with a personalist. And you begin with yourself. And you begin as an activist, changing yourself. Around the Catholic worker, they say, how is the Catholic worker run? Well, a person has authority not because he's been put in a position of authority. Everybody's a volunteer. But the person who, just by his very ability, takes over a situation is the authority, you might say. He's an authority on what he's doing. The person who knows how to bake bread automatically becomes the head of a baking project.
What happens when conflicts arise and when someone says, I can make bread better than you?
Mm-hmm. Well, if there's going to be a conflict, they can go ahead and take two separate tables and each bake their own bread. Take turns on the ovens, but we happen to have two ovens, too. No, there's the right to secession. That reminds you of the Quakers.
Yeah.
I went up to speak at a place in Westchester, and there were two Quaker meeting houses, not very far apart. And I said, well, what is this? Is this a hall or something of that sort? And they said, no, there was a disagreement between the two groups, and so they seceded and built another meeting house.
Mm.
So in an anarchist group, if there's a difference of opinion, why, the group was split.
The Catholic Worker Farm in upstate New York lives out the movement's anarchist and agrarian principles. Today, it attracts many young people who are seeking a religious, rural, and revolutionary lifestyle, a style which Dorothy, the Catholic Worker, has been living for over 40 years. Dorothy Day views this farm and others like it around the country as a new revolutionary development growing out of the peace movement. To many people, Dorothy Day is the leading example of how religious and nonviolent revolutionary life are related, and as such, she is one of the leading religious teachers and symbols of our time.
The Catholic Worker is essentially a school, you might say. I mean, it's a place where a lot of young people come to us. It's a anarchist movement. And they come to us to learn more about this point of view of beginning a change from the bottom up rather than from the top down through unions and credit unions. You do away with banks by credit unions. You do away with interest. You do away with by mutual aid. You do away with the possession of goods by sharing. Unions, credit unions, farming communes, cooperatives, all of these things.
This is all
a part of the anarchist point of view. A non-violent anarchist point of view, which you find a good deal of the anarchist, European anarchist literature.